It's really a terrific privilege to have James Wood with us this evening. He is, of course, one of the most prominent and best literary critics in the business today. And if you look at his biography to try to discern how he got to be that, it's not surprising to see that first, he got an early start. And second, he's been at it for some time now. His career began reviewing books for The Guardian not long after he left Cambridge. 20 years ago, he moved to America to work at The New Republic. And in 2007, he joined The New Yorker. Along the way, he also started teaching, first co-teaching with Saul Bellow at Boston University, and then for the past dozen years at Harvard, where he's now professor of the practice of literary criticism. Lest you think he was always intent on being a critic, that's not exactly the case. He has said that poetry was his first love, and he wrote, in his words, quote, reams and reams of bad verse, before realizing he lacked the qualities of concision and refinement, and then, too, he was getting more interested in narrative. His previous publications have included a novel, The Book Against God, and a study of storytelling titled How Fiction Works, as well as several collections of his essays. And now he's out with his latest collection, The Nearest Thing to Life, which fuses memoir and elements of James's own life with criticism and an eloquent consideration of such works as The Blue Flower, The Emigrants, and Chekhov's The Kiss. The result, as the New Journal of Books described it, is, quote, a beautifully written, compelling, and personal series of thoughts as to what makes fiction the nearest thing to life. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming James Wood.
Thank you very much for that wonderful introduction. It's great to be back here. Haven't been back for a few years, and indeed had to cancel, I think, my last appointment here. So it's a pleasure. Thank you very much. I'm a fake academic, despite that professor, or perhaps because of that professor of the practice nonsense. I don't have a PhD, and I hope that in what I'm about to read, you can tell that. That's not fair. I mean by that this book comes out of three lectures that I was asked to give in one place and another lecture somewhere else. And some people are very good at lectures, and I think real scholars who have who are in the middle of a true project are obviously the best candidates for writing lectures. I'm not very good at lectures, and I find that after about 4,000 words, that's to say about two-thirds of the way through a 7,000-word lecture, I run out of steam. When you run out of steam, and you don't have anything else to say about literature, then you talk about yourself. So what I was trying to do, I think, it only came apparent to me afterwards, in these four lectures, was say some general things about literature. And then, as I've always liked to do, connect literature naturally enough to life, and then to my own life, and it was interesting because it involved me in writing autobiographically, which I don't I wouldn't say happily do. I just don't do it very often. There isn't a lot of space in it, obviously enough, in ordinary journalism. So I'm just going to read a little bit from the last lecture in this. In this book, which is about leaving Britain for the States in 1995, actually for here in DC, not so far away in Woodley Park, the first half I talk about that experience, and then in the second half, which I won't read to you, I try to connect that to a new kind of literature that I think is being produced that has to do with emigration and immigration, but crucially not just immigration. We're used to that literature, but a back and forth structure, which is premised on an ability, a new ability, I think, of the last 20 or 30 years for immigrants to be able to come and go. I had a piano teacher who used to talk about the most familiar musical cadence, in which a piece returns after wandering in variation to its original key, the tonic, as going home. It seemed so easy when music did it. Who wouldn't want to swat away those black accidentals and come back to sunny C major? These satisfying resolutions are sometimes called perfect cadences. There's a lovely subspecies called the English cadence, used often by composers like Tallis and Byrd, in which, just before the expected resolution, a dissonance sharpens its blade and seems about to wreck things, and is then persuaded home, as it should be. I wish I could hear that English cadence again, the way I first properly heard it in Durham Cathedral. I was 11 years old. During the lesson, we choristers had been exchanging notes, probably sniggering at one of the more pompous priests, the one who, as he processed towards his stall, held his clasped hands pointed outward from his breast like a pious fish. And then we were up on our feet and were singing Onata Lux by Thomas Tallis. I knew the piece, but hadn't really listened to it. Now I was struck, assaulted, thrown, by its utter beauty, the soft equanimity of its articulation like the voice of justice, the sweet dissonance, welcome as pain. As the Tallis was ending, I saw a middle-aged woman with a canvas shoulder bag enter the shadowy hinterland at the back of the huge building. Standing so far away, a singular figure, she might have been a tentative tourist, but I knew the full bag. That coat I always wanted to be a bit more impressive than it was, the anxious rectitude of my mother's posture. She came every Tuesday afternoon noon because the girls' school she taught at got out early then. My parents lived only a mile or so from the cathedral, but I had to board. Tuesday afternoons, before I went back to school, gave me the chance to exchange a few words and grab whatever she brought in that bag, comics and sweets, and more reliably, socks. In my memory, this is exactly what happened. The radiance of the music, the revelation of its beauty, the final cadences of the Tallis, and my happy glimpsing of my mother. But it happened 38 years ago, and the scene has a convenient, dreamlike composition. Perhaps I have really dreamed it. As I get older, I dream more frequently of that magnificent cathedral, the long, grey, cool interior hanging somehow like memory itself. These are intense experiences from which I awake hearing every single note of a piece of remembered music. Happy dreams, never troubled. I like returning to that place in my sleep, even look forward to it. But real life is a different matter. The few occasions I've returned to Durham have been strangely disappointing. My parents no longer live there. I no longer live in the country. The city has become a dream. Herodotus says that the Scythians were hard to defeat because they had no cities or settled forts. They carry their houses with them and shoot with bows from horseback. Their dwellings are on their wagons. How can they fail to be invincible and inaccessible for others? To have a home is to become vulnerable, not just to the attacks of others, but to our own massacres of alienation. Our campaigns of departure and return threatened to become mere adventures in voiding. I left my home twice, the first time just after university when I went to London in the familiar march of the provincial for the metropolis. I borrowed £1,000 from the NatWest Bank in Durham, an account I still have, rented a van one way, put everything I owned into it, and drove south. I remember thinking as I waved at my parents and my sister that the gesture was both authentic and oddly artificial, the authorized novelistic journey. In this way, many of us, of course, are homeless, the exodus of expansion. The second departure occurred in 1995, when at the age of 30 I left Britain for the United States. I was married to an American, we had no children, and America would surely be new and exciting. We might even stay there for a few years, five at the most. I've now lived 20 years in the United States. It's feeble to say I didn't expect to stay as long, and ungrateful or even meaningless or dishonest to say I didn't want to. I must have wanted to. There's been plenty of gain. But I had so little concept of what might be lost. Losing a country, or losing a home, if I gave the matter much thought when I was young, was an acute world historical event, forcibly meted out on the victim, lamented and canonized in literature and theory, as exile or displacement, and defined with appropriate terminology by the Palestinian-American scholar Edward Said in his essay Reflections on Exile. And what Said writes, this is just a paragraph from his essay, is this: exile is strangely compelling to think about but terrible to experience. It's the unhealable rift forced between a human being and a native place, between the self and its true home. Its essential sadness can never be surmounted. In that essay, Said distinguishes between exile, refugee, expatriate, and emigre. Exile, as he understands it, is tragic homelessness, connected to the ancient punishment of banishment. He approves of Adorno's subtitle to Minima Moralia, Reflections from a Mutilated Life. It's hard to see how the milder, unforced journey I'm describing could possibly belong to this grander vision of suffering. Not going home is not the same as homelessness. That nice old boarding school standby, homesickness, might fit better, particularly if allowed a certain doubleness. I'm sometimes homesick, where homesickness is a kind of longing for Britain and an irritation with Britain, sickness for and sickness of. I bump into plenty of people in America who tell me that they miss their native countries, Britain, Germany, Russia, Holland, South Africa, and who in the next breath say they cannot imagine returning. It's possible, I suppose, to miss home terribly, not know what home really is anymore, and refuse to go home all at once. Such a tangle of feelings might then be the very definition of luxurious freedom, as far removed from Said's tragic homelessness as can be imagined. Logically, a refusal to go home should validate negatively the very idea of home, rather in the way that Said's idea of exile validates the idea of an original true home. But perhaps the refusal to go home is consequent upon the loss or lack of home, as if those fortunate expatriates were really saying to me, I couldn't go back home because I wouldn't know how to anymore. I've made a home in the United States, but perhaps it's not quite home. For instance, I have no strong desire to become an American citizen. Recently, when I arrived at Boston, the immigration officer commented on the length of time I've held a green card. A green card is usually considered a path to citizenship, he said, a sentiment both irritatingly reproving and movingly patriotic. I mumbled something about how he was perfectly correct and left it at that. But consider the fundamental openness and generosity of the gesture, along with the undeniable coercion. It's hard to imagine his British counterpart so freely offering citizenship, as if it were indeed uncomplicatedly on offer, a service or commodity. He was generously saying, would you like to be an American citizen? Along with the less generous, why don't you want to be an American citizen? Can we imagine either sentiment being expressed at Heathrow Airport? I don't think so. The poet and novelist Patrick McGuinness, in his book Other People's Countries, itself a rich analysis of home and homelessness, quotes Simenon, who was asked why he didn't change his nationality the way successful Francophone Belgians often did. Simenon replied, there was no reason for me to be born Belgian, so there's no reason for me to stop being Belgian. I wanted to say something similar, less wittily, no doubt, to the immigration officer, precisely because I don't need to become an American citizen. To take it would seem flippant, leave its benefits for those who need a new land. So whatever this state I'm talking about, this not going home, it's not tragic. There's probably something a bit ridiculous in these privileged laments. Oh, sing dem Harvard blues, white boy. But I'm trying to describe some kind of loss, some kind of falling away. The gain is obvious enough and thus less interesting to analyze. I asked Christopher Hitchens, long before he was terminally ill, where he would go if he only had a few weeks to live. Would he stay in America? No, I'd go to Dartmoor without a doubt, he told me. It was the landscape of his childhood. Dartmoor, not the M.D. Anderson Cancer Center in Houston. It's not uncommon for expatriates, emigres, refugees, and travelers to want to die at home. The desire to return after so long away is gladly irrational, and is perhaps premised on the loss of the original home. Home swells as a sentiment because it's disappeared as an achievable reality. Mariusa Tatarovich, the heroine of the novel A Foreign Woman by the Russian emigre writer Sergei Dovlatov, comes to the conclusion that she's made a mistake in leaving Russia for New York City. and decides to return. Dovlatov, who left the Soviet Union for America in 1979 and who appears as himself in that novel, tries to talk her out of it. "You've just forgotten what life is like there in Moscow," he says, "the rudeness, the lies." She replies, "If people are rude in Moscow, at least it's in Russian." But she stays in America. I once saw in Germany a small exhibition of Samuel Beckett's correspondence to his German publisher. Many brief note cards were arranged chronologically, the last written only a few months before his death. Beckett wrote to his publisher, not in German, but in French, a language in which he was, of course, deeply at home. But in the final year of his life, I noticed, he switched to English. "Going home," I thought. After so many years, life in America, or in my small part of America, has become my life, and life is made up of particulars, friends, conversation, dailiness of all sorts. I love, for instance, that certain New England states alert drivers that they are entering a built-up area with the sign, "thickly settled." I love the Hudson River, its steady brown flow. Generally, I like how most American rivers make their European rivals look like wan streams. There's the crimson livery of the Boar's Head trucks, or the way the mailman delivering the post in the dark winter afternoon wears a little miner's lamp on his head and peers down at his paper bundle. Large American radiators in old apartment buildings with their hissing and ghostly clanking. A certain general store in New Hampshire that sells winter boots, hand cream, excellent bacon, and firearms. I cherish the phrase, "take it easy," and the scandalous idea that people would actually say this to each other. But there's always the reality of a certain outsiderdom. Take the beautiful American train horn, the crushed klaxon peal you can hear almost anywhere in the States, at the end of my street at nighttime, across a New Hampshire valley, in some small Midwestern town, a crumple of notes, blown out on an easy, loitering wail. It sounds less like a horn than a sudden prairie wind or an animal's cry. That big, easy loiter is, for me, the sound of America, whatever America is. But it must also be the sound of America for thousands, perhaps millions of non-Americans. It's a shared possession, not a personal one. I'm outside it. I appreciate it as something slightly distant. It's unhistorical for me. It doesn't have my past in it, drags no old associations. We lived about half a mile from the Durham station when I was a kid, and from my bedroom at night I could hear the arrhythmic thunder of the big yellow-nosed Deltic diesels as they pulled their shabby carriages onto the Victorian viaduct that curves out of town, bound for London or Edinburgh, and sometimes blew their parsimonious horns, the British Rail Minor Third. Or perhaps it is actually a minor third. It goes, bop, bop, like that. Well, suppose I'm looking down our Boston street in dead summer. I see a familiar life, the clabbered houses, the porches, the heat mirage hanging over the patched road, snakes of asphalt like black chewing gum, the grey cement walks, signed in one place when the cement was new by three young siblings, the heavy maple trees, the unkempt willow down at the end, an old white Cadillac with the bumper sticker, "Ted Kennedy has killed more people than my gun." And I feel nothing, no past, despite all the years I've lived there, or not enough, some recognition, but not enough comprehension. Just a tugging distance from it all. A panic suddenly overtakes me, and I wonder, how did I get here? And then the moment passes. An ordinary life closes itself around what had seemed, for a moment, a desperate lack. Edward Said says that it's no surprise that exiles are often novelists, chess players, intellectuals. The exile's new world, he writes, logically enough, is unnatural, and its unreality resembles fiction, close quote. He reminds us that Georg Lukács considered the novel the great form of what Lukács called transcendental homelessness. I'm certainly not an exile, but it's sometimes hard to shake the unreality that Said speaks of. I watch my children grow up as Americans in the same way that I might read about or create fictional characters. They are not fictional, of course, but their Americanism can sometimes seem unreal to me. I have an American eighth grader, I say to myself with amazement as I watch my daughter perform at one of those dastardly school events always held in gymnasiums. Doubtless amazement attends all the strange stages of a child's growth. All is unexpected, but there's also that strange distance, that light veil of alienation thrown over everything. And then there's the same light veil thrown over everything when I go back to Britain, too. When I was first living in the States, I was eager to keep up with life back at home. who was in the cabinet, the new music, what people were saying in the newspapers, how the schools were doing, the shape of friends' lives. It became harder to do so, of course, because the meaning of these things grew less and less personal. For me, English reality has disappeared into memory, has changed itself to past, as Philip Larkin has it. I know very little about modern daily life in London or Edinburgh or Durham. There's a quality of masquerade when I return, as if I were putting on my wedding suit to see if it still fits. In America, I crave often the English reality that has disappeared. Childhood seems breathingly close. But the sense of masquerade persists. I gorge on nostalgia, on fondnesses that might have embarrassed me when I lived in Britain. Jeff Dyer writes funnily in his book, Out of Sheer Rage, about how, when he was living in Italy, he developed an obsession with reading the TV listings in English papers, even though he'd never watched telly when he lived in England and didn't like it. To hear a northern voice, northern English voice, on an American news program leaves me flushed with longing. The dance of that dialect with its seasick Scandinavian pitch, and all those fabulous words, segs, the metal plates you'd bang onto your shoe heels to make sparks on the ground and act like a bit of a hard nut. Kets, sweets, neb, nose, nout, nothing, stotty cake, a kind of flat, doughy bread, claggy, sticky. The way northerners say E as an exclamation. E, it's red hot today. Any temperature over about 72 degrees. Recently I heard the old song, When the Boat Comes In on National Public Radio, and almost wept. And it goes like this. Now come here, little Jackie, now I've smoked me backy, let's have some cracky till the boat comes in, and you shall have a fishy on a little dishy, you shall have a fishy when the boat comes in. But I really disliked that song when I was a boy. I never had a very northern accent. My father was born in London. It was important to my Scottish petty bourgeois mother that I didn't sound like a northerner. Friends used to say with a bit of menace in their voices, you don't talk like a Durham lad. Where are you from? Sometimes it was necessary to mimic the accent to fit in, to avoid getting beaten up. I could never say, as the man in the song Coming Home Newcastle foolishly does, and I'm proud to be a Geordie and to live in Geordie land. My town was the university and the cathedral. It seemed that almost everyone who lived on our street was an academic, like my father, or a clergyman, and they didn't sound like northerners. How vivid all those neighbours are in my mind. And how strange they were. I think now that in the 1970s I caught the fading comet end of allowable eccentricity. There was Mrs. Jolly, though she was in fact anything but, who walked with three canes, one for the left leg and two bound together with string for the right. There was the dry, bony lecturer in classical epigraphy, Dr. Fowler, who was fond of repeating as a kind of motto, "Tell it not in Gath." Next door to us, separated only by a wall, lived a profoundly learned scholar, the university librarian. He knew many languages and pages of Dickens by heart, and sometimes we would hear him pacing up and down, reciting and laughing. This academic religious world had obscure prohibitions and rules. There was a historian who, for some reason, forbade his two slightly green-hued, fearsomely clever daughters from watching the Forsyte saga on television. That was the first iteration of the Forsyte saga in the late 60s and 70s. And a thrifty professor of divinity whose household had no television, and who, according to my mother, always had sausages, never turkey, on Christmas Day. That family's fantastical drabness, sealed in my childish mind by the information that he and his wife and three children exchanged only cotton handkerchiefs as presents. Our headmaster at the Durham Chorister School, also a clergyman, told us that we should start our essays with a bang. Bacon began his essay on gardens. God Almighty first planted a garden. Try to emulate Bacon. He had an elaborate system of mnemonics to help us with difficult Latin words. Whenever the word unde, U-N-D-E, unde appeared in a text, he would suck on his pipe and intone in Oxonian basso, Marks and Spencer, Marks and Spencer. This was supposed to trigger, from where do you get your undies, your underwear commonly bought in those days at the chain of stores known as Marks and Spencer. And the answer, from Marks and Spencer. And then lead us to the meaning of the word, which is where, or from where. As you can see, I haven't forgotten it. I think I will end at that moment. So, happy to take any questions that they don't have to be about you know, this form of emigration. They can also be other, there are other issues about fiction or reviewing or whatever comes to mind. And if there are no questions, I could just, you know, read a bit more. That's fine, too.
I have a comment. Before you began, I, sitting over here, looked at the assorted group, and I did not find them warm-hearted.
Oh.
I thought they seemed rather selfish and petty and just so interested in their own little things.
Oh.
And then you transformed them into caring, sensitive.
Be careful. I think you're going to have a problem getting out of the doors of this shop if you're not careful.
They all became warm-hearted. And they all became people that one could be quite proud of belonging to.
Oh, well, I like to hear that.
As Americans, and I think you bring out the best.
All because
Americans.
Of my words. Well, thank you very much. I'm delighted to hear that. I don't know what to say. Surely that's not quite true. The transformation can't be as acute as you say it was, but I'll accept the praise anyway. Thank you. Yes, well, I mean, more seriously, when I that lecture was actually delivered in London, so it was curious. Obviously, I was speaking largely to an English audience, but I was trying to talk about a mixture of things. Right, I was trying to talk about loss and gain, and to talk about happy experiences in America as well as an increasing nostalgia, I think, as I just inevitably, probably as I get older, for what's gone, and so I suppose there was a sense of trying to bring an audience into a circle. Yeah, yes, indeed. I'm supposed to say that you should go to the microphone because the event is being videoed.
Well, I have not a question, but a request that you could expand a little bit. You talked about the new type of literature about immigration, and I thought maybe you could talk a little bit about that and give us some examples of the books or whatever that you would consider in that category.
Happily. So I think the way to think about it is of course there's for a long time been literature of immigration, going back to, I mean, at least there's a great novel from the 30s called Call It Sleep, that some of you will know by Henry Roth, and then in the 50s and 60s and 70s you get something that's now anointed as sort of post-colonialism, which is often literature written by people who, sometimes it's written by people who had stayed in former colonial countries in Africa or obviously or India or the Caribbean, or obviously case would be someone like V.S. Naipaul who made a journey from one of those countries to a colonial or an imperial center. But who had complicated feelings about going back, perhaps. Dovlatov, who I mentioned in the talk, is an example of Russian Jewish immigration in the 70s and early 80s. And of course, we can think back to non-Jewish Russian immigration in the case of Nabokov. In both those cases, you had writers who could not return to Russia, or who profoundly didn't want to because for political reasons. What you have now, it seems to me, one way you can think about it is that what you have now is literature being produced by the children of those post-colonial pioneers. And obviously they have different experiences because many of them were born anyway in places like America or in Britain. Or you have literature produced by, I mean, there's a new wave of fiction being written by Russian Jewish immigrants who came as children to the States or to Canada. I'm thinking of people like David Besmozges in the 80s and 90s, but who, unlike their parents, can return to Russia and see it as a fairly natural thing for them to be able to come and go. Indeed, they might have relatives in Russia. They might even, in the case of someone like Keith Gessen, they might actually return to Russia and write journalism about returning to Russia. So I think what you're finding is, I've written about Open City by Teju Cole, who's a Nigerian writer who came to America as a child, I think, and lives in New York. I think you're inevitably getting a literature that that is about emigration and displacement, but it's also about going back and forth in a way that is different from the a single journey trajectory of the earlier literature. And I guess Alexander Hemon would be another example, a Bosnian American writer who came from Sarajevo in the 90s and at first couldn't go back because Sarajevo was, as you remember, under siege, and now of course can go back, does go back, writes a column for a Sarajevo newspaper, but is also an American writer. So it's that sense of being able to quite easily bolt things on that interests me, and obviously interested me because of how I was thinking about my experience of coming here and being, you know, recognizably English, but also having more and more an American experience that's displacing the English one, even though I'm not an American citizen. Yeah. Apparently, yes, for the video purposes. Yeah, yeah.
So, as someone who's made America my home, I'm from Egypt,
mm-hmm.
and I've been here for nearly 10 years. I relate to this privileged lament you speak of, because I chose to leave.
Yes.
And I could leave. I also came to you earlier through your broken estate,
mm-hmm.
and I believe it was called absolute literature, or maybe I viewed it as such.
Yeah.
This, like a spiritual homelessness almost.
Yeah.
Where literature took the place of other, you know, other
right.
sacred estates.
Right.
Is that still the state beyond nation state for you, where you find a home in literature?
Well, before I answer that, let me just ask you, if you wouldn't mind, because this is interesting to me.
Sure.
That seems to be something that's dear to you. In other words,
it is. I'm here to hear what you have to say.
In other words, literature. Yeah. Well, I dread to disappoint you. That's
I
why
do.
I'm holding you just a second longer, yeah. so that
sure.
I don't have to.
Sure.
But so literature, as for you, not just the geographical and cultural
right.
displacement,
beyond
but also a spirit. And how would you define that spiritual loss?
I thought you had the absolute literature. It could have been a translator of Kafka's who coined the term
right.
Richard something or other. I can't
right.
Grasso or some. I can't
right.
remember the name. I think it means that you're homeless at home to begin with.
Right.
So you don't need to leave to feel
right.
that homelessness
absolutely.
Or the longing. You
right.
you carry that with you wherever you go.
Right.
And literature becomes the place where you have your sacred moments, your epiphanies,
yeah.
your sense of belonging, I suppose.
Yeah, yeah. I think that's very true. I like that idea of course, you're right, absolutely right, of feeling homeless even when you're at home for a variety of reasons. I mean, it could well be to do with some feeling of spiritual loss or just feeling that you're out of kilter with a culture. And I think that's right. I mean, later on in that essay, I do talk about Sebald's The Emigrants.
Mm.
And although he was himself an emigrant who left Germany and came to England and made a life for 30 years in England, he could have gone back to Germany. He chose not to. He could have gone back to Germany, and I also think that he's the kind of writer that even if he'd stayed in Germany, he'd have still probably produced the same kind of
sure.
writing. He'd have still been interested. He was particularly interested, as we know, in people who found themselves either physically or spiritually homeless in Nazi Germany, not just Nazi Germany, but elsewhere too. But the only caveat I would suggest, and it's not like a caveat that I'm pushing at you. It's more something I try to wrestle with a little myself, as someone who grew up in a religious household and passed out of that religious experience, and in some ways found literature as some kind of alternative home, is I think one just has to be a little beware of that substitution narrative. In other words, it's obvious enough if you have a religious upbringing and then you no longer believe, but you find literature sacred or holy, that some sort of transference or displacement has gone on. But one wouldn't want to insist on it too much, only because one of the great things about literature is that it isn't the same as religion, right? And so simply to transfer the same feelings you might have had about God or about formal belief to literature, which I certainly in the case of the European novel does seem to be rather wonderfully largely a secular and comic form, one doesn't want to do it too much. Yeah. I don't know if that seems right to you too. Yeah. So as in all these things, it's some matter of making distinctions, even as you feel the force of exactly what you're talking about, of that substitution. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yes.
I read your very powerful New Yorker essay on Carl Ove Knausgård in the New Yorker, and was very moved by it and started reading Knausgård. And I just wonder what you think now after much more of his work has been published. I think it was just the first novel you had reviewed.
Yeah, thank you. So it was a review I wrote about Karl Ove Knausgård's My Struggle, this Norwegian writer who's now published in English, four volumes of a six-volume sort of memoir come novel. I thought what you were going to say was, I liked your moving review, and then I read Knausgård and was completely disappointed by it, which can happen. So, you know, those of you who've read this Norwegian writer will know what we're talking about. And I have now read all four volumes. And I don't actually like the last two as much as the first two. And maybe the first is the best, because the first has a real... it has a really dramatic story, which is about... just the discovery of death, and particularly in his case, the news that comes to him I suppose he's 19 or something like that, maybe early 20s, that his father, who was an alcoholic, has drunk himself to death, and the journey that he and his brother make to his father's house, where his father was also living with the grandmother, who was the sort of arch enabler of the alcoholism, to clean the house. To rid it of its years of, quite literally, sort of excrement. Just clean out the shit, and that is it's a wonderful. It actually gives a handrail for the book in ways that perhaps three and four don't so much. But that's the first. So that's the first story, really, is the father, and then the second volume is child, is being a parent. Which I think is also very, very good. He's always sort of wrestling with these questions that are interesting to, I mean, not just to writers, but to anyone who has children, which is, you know, how you make a space for yourself as an individual doing what you want to do while also attending to children in their individuality. And he must like it, despite his complaints, because he now has four of them. So I think we have to take a slight pinch of salt, the stuff about, oh, I have to push the stroller along the streets of Oslo, and, you know, all this sort of stuff. And then volume three is in a way the most plotless. That's just him sinking into his childhood, and has wonderful things in it. But it's a strange thing as a it's a strange thing as a I obviously didn't have this experience when I was writing for the New Republic, which had a readership of sort of 60,000, and no one really gave two hoots about anything that appeared in the magazine much. But it's a strange thing to be in the position of, in the case of Knausgård, sort of launching a phenomenon. Of course, I wasn't aware of it when I did. I just was reviewing the book. And then suddenly, his face is on the front of the cover, and people will come up to you and say, "You're completely wrong about Knausgård. He's boring, self-involved, and you're to blame." It's a sort of, I just reviewed the book in at hand. But there are some bad days when I walk into the bookshop and I see his glowering granite-like features, and I think, "Oh, what have I wrought? What have I wrought?" But no, I'm joking. It's wonderful. It's wonderful stuff. And apparently, volume 6 is the one we should all be waiting for, because it has a mad 80-page essay on Hitler. Always implied by the title, and finally fulfilled in the final one. So that we've got that to look forward to. Yeah.
I wanted to ask you about criticism. It seems I read a lot of negative reviews, and I kind of wonder where the imperative is to publish those. Just because it's someone who wrote a good book once before, or how do you decide that it's just so bad that we can't do it, even though it's someone famous? And why don't they decide that more often, maybe?
Do you like the negative? Do you like the presence of negative reviews? Or
no, I don't actually. I mean, okay. I guess I'm looking for things what I want to read.
Yeah.
And I read a lot, and I feel like it's a waste of real estate in the newspaper or magazine to spend a lot of time, even if it's a famous person. Mm-hmm. Find something. I mean, not that everything has to be positive, but at some point it goes over. The line of, if this is so bad, why are you wasting space? I guess that's my question, is how do you decide, editorially, how to do that or when not to?
That's a good question. I sort of think almost the other way. Not. I don't mean that the world should be full of negative reviews, but I slightly think that if you've got the bit between your teeth, you should go a bit right. That, in other words, if you've done 2,000 words of negativity, actually another 2 is even better, because you haven't done the task properly. And that's actually true. I mean, so recently, this book, I was about 2 or 3 weeks ago, I was sort of self-pityingly saying to myself, this book's been out since April, hasn't had any reviews at all. It's true, actually, it hasn't even been reviewed in the Times book review or anything. And I think it's because it's from a small publisher, university publisher, and because it has the dread thing on the back, lectures, so be careful what you wish for, because I go online and a guy called Peter Craven, he's a sort of street fighter in Sydney, Australia, has reviewed the book, very short review, sort of 500 words, for the Sydney Morning Herald. It begins, "What is it about this book that's so incredibly tiresome?" And then, that's great. Then it goes on. It's not that Wood is wrong. He's often quite right. But when he's right, he's not quite right enough. And that he delivers his pronouncements like a middling character actor who thinks he's auditioning for Prospero, but has actually landed the part of Polonius. Pretty good. And it also has the wonderful line, "Much of this book reads like a critic who's got too big for his boots," which I feel like that seems, you can just hear that in Australians. Like, "Much of this book reads like a critic who's just too big for his boots. Needs to be taken down a bit." You can really, it's real sort of tough, Anyway, but what I thought reading it, after I'd got over the initial, rage and tearfulness, was this isn't even a takedown. You 500 words isn't enough. If you come at me with 5,000 and say, here, I'm going to lay out exactly systematically what's wrong with the whole project from beginning to end, I'd hate it, but at least it's proper. So I'm just being a bit... I'm being a bit silly, but it's simply to...
Plus, you write for The New Yorker, which
right,
is...
Right, I do have the space. And, of course, right. I understand what you mean about it, particularly in a time when, you know, let's say 30 years ago, probably there was more space for that kind of reasoned negativity. And now, yeah, when it's so... When space is so tight, why waste it? One of the reasons I... It's not a reason why I left The New Republic. That's not true. But one of the things I've enjoyed about writing for a different magazine is that small magazines have a naturally combative, slightly militant atmosphere. Right? It's sort of it's us against them, and I think rightly, because they're not read by very many people, they take seriously the business of judgment for and against. It's a little harder to do that, as you suggest, at length without for a larger magazine without boring people or losing them. And one of the things I've enjoyed at The New Yorker is doing a bit less of that and discovering writers, people that are new to me and that I think will be interesting to and new to most readers, and bringing the readers along. And I've written plenty of negative reviews in my time, of course, but I do really believe that it's a truism that the critic who can make you like something is the truer critic than the critic who can just make you understand that something's not right. On the other hand, there's a lot of fraudulence around, right? I mean, you know, there'll be a few people here who take against me when I say this, but you know, if Tom Wolfe comes out, you know, with this great flabby, exclamatory, crude book, and calls it a serious novel, and then gets described as Dickensian by you know, X, Y, and Z, there's a moral task involved in saying to the reader, no. You're being cheated here. Here's Dickens. Have a look at that. What Dickens represents. Now have a look at Tom Wolfe, and here's the particular way in which you're being cheated. And of course, that is a serious business, because one can negate in the name of an ideal, and that's right too, and that's part of being a critic. I just find I do it less than I used to, partly also because I'm just a bit more tender-hearted than I was 15 years ago. Is that because I've been reviewed harshly myself a bit? Probably it is a little over the years, yeah. Yeah.
Actually, good segue into my question. Are there any novels or genre that you disliked in the past that you've actually come to like?
Right.
And think differently about, and maybe in terms of some of the themes you're exploring now.
Thank you. Well, thank you for that. There are certain writers who I have... and so David Foster Wallace would be one who I've revisited... because I felt that I hadn't done him justice. Right, with a complicated, difficult writer like that, the easiest thing to do is to read a few pages and say, it's not me. You know, the voice annoys me in some way, or I can't be bothered with the footnotes, whatever it is. And I have my, you know, human share of laziness along with everyone else. I'm challenged by books that I can't be bothered to be challenged by, and I put them down. And he'd be an example of a writer that I felt my negativity about was not just, really, or at least I needed to revisit. So I've deliberately tried to teach his short stories to students, because I find that's the best way of slowing down and decoupling yourself from judgment. Right, the students don't want to know whether you hate a writer. I mean, that's going to they want to know, you know, how a story works and what its meaning is, and that's been very, very good for me. So there are specific writers I think I've tried to, or have changed my feelings about. Genres not particularly, because I've always liked, because I've never really bothered with genre fiction. So it's not something it's not that I had a decided aversion to it and then, you know, crime fiction or whatever. It's simply that I didn't read it much and still don't. I just find that the sort of genreless novel that goes everywhere, or short story that goes everywhere, happily occupies all my space and time. Yeah. Thanks.
I was just thinking, you know, I've read a lot of immigrant literature from Bharati Mukherjee and others.
Yeah.
Where would you place a writer or an exiled or self-exiled writer like Joyce, for example,
uh-huh.
that he left Dublin at the age of 22,
yes,
I'm told, and he roamed around Europe,
yes.
mostly in France and Switzerland and Northern Italy, etc. And he wrote Ulysses,
yeah.
which is about Dublin.
Yes.
And during the war.
And a book full of joy, too. Yes, I think I'm glad you raised Joyce, because the Said essay I mentioned is very moving, but I hadn't read it since I was probably a student, and then I you know, for the purposes of that thing, I reread it, and I was surprised by how firmly tragic Said's view of exile was, right? And also I was surprised by the insistence that exile is the separation from a true home, because it seems to me it's implicit in your question that one of the things that happens, even perhaps with tragic exile, is that the idea of the idea of a true home gets modified, right? It disappears a little bit. It's harder to find, and you're probably not at the end of your life still talking about a true home. Perhaps there are some people indeed who are talking about true homes and looking back, but and obviously, specifically, especially in the case of someone like Said, who in one way is obviously enough addressing absolute loss, Palestinian loss. And on the other hand, it seemed to me that what he wasn't writing about in that essay was his own involvement in that process, which was indeed relatively privileged, right? So,
yeah.
So I think, for instance, Joyce is a very good person to bring up, because there you have, it seems to belong to that earlier period of, you know, tragic wandering exile emigration, but as you suggest, it was largely chosen, and anyway produced not tragic literature, but comic literature,
exactly.
Happily building back that world that of his childhood.
And about the place he had left.
Yes.
Whereas I think in the case of Edward Said, the problem, the key sentence there in that essay mm-hmm. or in another place is, he talked of the mind in winter, which uh-huh. is Wallace Stevens'
yes.
mind.
Yes,
the yes. exilic experience. But I think in his case, one of the factors was the country he came from.
Yes.
Was in such sad state of affairs.
Right, of course.
So basically,
right.
he couldn't go back, or
right.
maybe he did go back.
Yeah.
But it was in a tragic state.
Yes.
Itself, the his home disappeared.
Absolutely. No, it's not in any way to diminish the element of loss. It's just that,
And secondly, his failure to adjust totally to the U.S. I think that is part of the problem also. Whereas, as you suggested, that when there is an immigrant or an emigre,
right.
he willingly comes in and he cannot go back.
Right.
Now, for example, I am in that state.
Right.
I am originally from Pakistan.
Uh-huh.
And I've lived here for 40 years now.
Yes.
Approximately, and my children have grown up here, et cetera, et cetera. And I've been writing, dabbling with some
yes.
kind of writing. But... again, it's not exilic literature. I too, in the in the type of Joycean,
right.
I wrote a novel about the 60s Pakistan,
right,
which was my childhood experience.
Yeah.
So I there was.
And
no,
you can go back, and do go back.
I do not, because of the weather conditions. It's very, very hot, and
right.
things have changed
sure.
now.
Yeah.
And in the last 10 years, the country is turned
right.
into a crazy place.
Sure, sure.
So that's part of
sure,
the
sure. Well, thank you very much
not
for that.
Thank you.
Yeah.
You know, we're about a week away from what's been built up as one of the biggest literary events of the year, the release of Go Set a Watchman.
Yeah.
Do you... What do you make, first off, of of this whole situation, and do you have any plans to review the book?
No, I'm not going to write about it. You've caught me out there. This is about the Harper Lee sequel. I don't really have any views about it. It seems a bit shady, doesn't it? I'm just saying a commonplace there, that it does seem a little bit cooked up, and it is too bad that she doesn't seem capable of being able to speak forthrightly about the conditions of the publication. But it seems, and it also seems that the sheer logic of sequels, even if it's not a sequel, suggests that it has to be a disappointment, right? I mean, that we have to ready ourselves for that too. But remember when after Ralph Ellison's death, his executor produced Juneteenth, which was the book that he was working on for all those years, and had the same feeling. It's like it didn't really need to exist. It was, I mean, it was a sort of scholarly interest, I suppose, but it was a shame in a way, because it didn't cohere. That was the book that Ellison was sort of working on for 30 years of his life, and when people said to him, I always love this, when people said to him, so why aren't you publishing it? What are you working on? What are you finding difficult? And he would say, "I'm working on the transitions." Simply, some sort of weirdly funny, but also tragic. It's like, yeah, you can understand the transitions, right? And actually, it came when you looked at Juneteenth. It was the transitions that were a bit of a problem. But I wish I had more to say about Harper Lee. I don't. Like everyone else, I read To Kill a Mockingbird at school in Britain, and I can't remember much about it because I was. I know that sounds sort of strange, but what you have to understand here is that because I didn't have an American childhood, it sort of existed there as a. I mean, this was the same time when someone gave me Shane to read. You remember that book about Shane, the West, it sort of existed as a strange sort of denatured object. Someone said, you must read To Kill the Mockingbird. You will read it. You are 12 or whatever it was at school. And then it wasn't carried on in an important way. That's to say, because I wasn't an American, Harper Lee meant nothing to me. To Kill a Mockingbird meant nothing to me. I certainly didn't see the film for ever, I think. I mean, I've seen bits of the film now. I know Gregory Peck standing there in the courtroom and so on. But it had no resonance. So in the way in which children put away childish things, I just forgot about it. And I've never really bothered myself much with To Kill the Mockingbird since, and I think that's different for Americans, for whom it remains a thread, and then their own children, of course, read it too.
Well, I asked in part because I thought maybe you could write more dispassionately about this whole.
Well, I probably could. You can see I'm dispassionate to a fault. I don't remember anything about it, so that'll be great. I'm just clearly the man for it. Yeah, my daughter actually just read it in school and liked it very much. So it's funny to see them canon, all this stuff about canon wars and so on. What was all the anxiety about, right? I mean, 10 or 15 years ago, there was all this anxiety, the canon is being destroyed. Absolute nonsense. The canon is an incredibly sluggish, heavy thing that doesn't get destroyed, right? What is my daughter reading? Oh, well, it would be To Kill a Mockingbird. It would be Lord of the Flies, for goodness sake, and then 1984. Well, that would be my childhood too. It's absolutely incredible to me. Of course, there are a few add-ons, sort of Sherman Alexie or whatever, but it's absolutely amazing how staid and conservative education is in that regard. Yeah. Anyway, I've blabbed on long enough. Thank you very much indeed.